HarperCollins presents The Drowning Isle by Simon McCleave, read by Alice White. To Lee, Kaylee, Lowry and Serin, kiss. Anglesey. There is a word in Welsh that has no exact translation into English, hiraeth. It is best defined as the bond you feel with the place, a mixture of pride, homesickness, and a determination to return. Most people that have visited Anglesey leave with an understanding of hiraeth. Ynyslanddwyn. The small tidal island of Ynyslanddwyn, just off the southwest coast of Anglesey, is named after the patron saint of Welsh lovers, Dwynwen. It is believed she lived in the 5th century and was the daughter of King Brychan Brycheiniog. She fell in love with a man named Malon, whom she was forced by her father to reject. Dwynwen subsequently dedicated herself to helping those unhappy in their love lives, eventually building a home on this remote island. The ruins of a medieval church dedicated to Dwynwen can still be seen today, and 14th century poet Dafydd ap Gwilym claimed he saw a golden image of her at the site when he visited. Every year, on the 25th of January, Wales celebrates St. Dwynwen's Day, similar to St. Valentine's Day in many places around the world. Thomas Pennant's account from the 1770s mentions small ruins nearby being the Prebendal House, which housed Richard Cuffin in the 15th century. He worked with Sir Rhys ap Thomas and other Welsh chieftains to plan for Henry Tudor's return from exile in Brittany, using fishing vessels to send intelligence to him. At St. Dwynwen's Well, on Ynyslanddwyn Island, a sacred fish is said to predict the fate of couples in love, while unsettled waters in the well signals good luck and contentment. Nearby are two beacons, one that looks like a windmill tower but has been abandoned, the other a guide for ships passing through the perilous Menai Strait, with cottages built to house the pilots who boarded them. In December 1852, this lighthouse saved 36 people from 3 shipwrecks within 7 days. Rocks and geology from about 500 million years ago form the foundations of Ynyslanddwyn Island, where pillow lavas gracing its beaches demonstrate the awesome underwater forces that shaped it, beginning south of New Zealand. The island has been named in the first 100 World Geological Heritage Sites list, key geological sites of international scientific relevance with a substantial contribution to the development of geological sciences through history. This place also forms part of a national nature reserve, which includes Newborough Warren to the south and the Kevney Salt Marsh to the north, all managed by Natural Resources Wales. Prologue. The teenage boy came out of the dense, alpine-like Newborough forest and glanced around. He then made his way through the grassy dunes of Newborough Beach, which was located on the southwest coast of Anglesey, an island off the coast of North Wales. "It looks different, doesn't it?" the boy thought in his confused state. Even though he'd been to Newborough dozens of times before, it looked different. But there was a good reason why it looked different that afternoon. He was hallucinating from the magic mushroom-laced chocolate that he'd eaten with his friends about an hour earlier, plus a few slugs of vodka and a toke on some weed. He didn't know where his friends had gone. He didn't really care. They were probably still dancing and playing around in the forest, tripping the light fantastic. They were all camping overnight in Newborough to celebrate their 18th birthdays. Ahead of him, there were shallow pools, gullies and small channels that dissected the vast expanse of the sandy beach. The surface water shimmered in the glow of the sun. Colours were changing. Shards of pink, turquoise, purple and green. What was it that John Lennon had written? Tangerine trees and marmalade skies. Wow, that looks amazing, he thought, even though he got the feeling that he'd been distracted from something that had frightened him. He noticed he was out of breath, but couldn't remember why. Someone or something had been chasing him in the forest, was that right? The voice in his head seemed to echo, as if in a deep cave. It felt like he was walking around in his own dream. God, I'm properly fucked. His eyes rested back on the plethora of colours that emanated in a shimmering medley. It must have been what the Beatles had seen when they took LSD and wrote tracks for Sgt. Pepper's. Cool. He loved that album. His mates could keep Sam Fender. Beyond the shallow pools lay the tidal island of Llanddoyne. To the south, the spectacular landscape of Snowdonia, formed over 500 million years ago. God, this is so beautiful. To the east, the vast dark expanse of Caernarvon Bay, and then the Irish Sea. At low tide, a winding path lay across the neck of sand from the mainland to this isle. The island itself was covered with crowberry, liverwort, and hair lichen. Close to the church ruins was Doynwen's Well, where nuns had blessed visitors to the island with holy water 1,600 years ago. To the right of the ruins, a moss-covered memorial, a huge stone Celtic cross, stood on the higher ground of the island's northwest tip with the inscription, "In memory of St. Doynwen, 25th of January, 465. Glancing back across the dunes from where he'd come, the boy spotted the dark figure that had been chasing him, emerging from the darkness of the forest. It hadn't been a figment of his hallucination after all. Oh shit! What do they want? Why are they chasing me? For a moment, he wondered if it was one of his mates playing a trick on him. But it wasn't. Suddenly, the person ran towards him aggressively, shouting at him to listen. Fuck, I'd better get out of here, he thought. Is this even really happening? Now, full of panic, the boy turned and sprinted away along the beach. The salty wind stung in his nostrils. The gulls cawed from the sky above him as if they were urging him on to escape. Go on, run, run away. His legs felt leaden, as if they didn't even belong to him. Every step was a struggle. His body felt drained of energy. All he wanted to do was lie down in the sand and look up at the sky. Come on, you've got to bloody run. The lethargic feeling cleared as quickly as it had come. With a sudden clarity, the teenage boy darted along the sand, the sound of the footsteps behind him getting louder. Just keep running, he told himself. He tried to shout for help, but his throat was dry and nothing more than a rasping sound came out. Petrified with fear, he was trying to work out why they were chasing him. Or was this a dream? The drugs were playing havoc with his sense of reality. Is this really happening, or am I imagining it? Whoever was behind him was getting closer and closer. They were gasping, panting, murmuring some kind of incantation. The boy's heart pounded wildly in his chest. Maybe he could just stop and reason with his pursuer? No. What if they attack you and kill you? His paranoia and fear were overwhelming. Glancing back, he saw the figure behind. It looked like they were wearing some kind of mask. But then their face changed and morphed into something else. Jesus, what the hell is going on? Is this just some horrible figment dragged up from my subconscious? The drugs were hindering his ability to separate reality from hallucination. The boy continued running, pumping his arms as he sucked for air. His lungs were now burning. Please, don't let me die here. Looking back over his shoulder again, the boy ran into a rock he didn't see ahead of him, which took his legs out from under him and sent him crashing face first into the sand. He gasped as the wind was knocked out of his chest. Bloody hell! He tried to get his breath. And then his pursuer was on him like a flash. They were shouting something at him through gritted teeth. What the hell do you want? Just tell me, the boy demanded, as he looked up at a face that he suddenly realised he recognised. The boy lashed out and punched his pursuer. You're pathetic, the boy shouted angrily as he struggled. Pathetic and stupid. Then a vice-like grip seized his throat. Choking, gasping, coughing. Chapter 1. April 2022. 48 hours earlier. It was 6:15 a.m. and Detective Inspector Laura Hart of the Anglesey Police Force stood on the flat, wet, sandy beach at Beaumaris and took a lungful of fresh sea air. This was Laura's morning routine. Well, at least 4 or 5 times a week. "Race you in," said a voice. It was her 19-year-old daughter, Rosie. She had blonde hair tied back off of her face, bright blue eyes and a fair complexion. She was on the tall side, with a small button nose and rosebud lips, and wore a nose ring and 2 earrings in the top of each ear. She was smart and good-natured. Laura pulled a face. "Really? Let me just ready myself." "Wimp," Rosie laughed, as she ran forward, her feet patting noisily on the sand as she went. She gave a yelp as she hit the icy sea but didn't stop. Pushing on through the waves, she arched into a dive and then disappeared under the water for a few seconds before bursting through the surface with a victorious woo-hoo! "That's my girl," Laura thought, with a mixture of pride and relief, glad to see her daughter happy for once. It had been just over a month since Rosie had been kidnapped and buried alive by serial killer Henry Marsh. It had left psychological scars, with Rosie experiencing night terrors and panic attacks. And even though she was receiving excellent trauma counselling, Rosie was still struggling. Laura had read about the huge benefits on mental health of cold water swimming. Apparently, immersion into the icy sea induced something called a cold shock response. This was a gasp reflex, the constriction of blood vessels close to the surface of the skin as your body tries to conserve heat. This was combined with a raised heart rate and hyperventilation, though repeated exposure to this process diminished the trauma response. The cold water therapy taught your body and its nervous system to adapt. "Mum? Hello?" Rosie yelled from the sea. "Today would be good." "You cheeky bugger," Laura shouted back. In that moment, the rhythmic whoosh of the waves and the salty fragrance of the sea seemed to intensify. Looking across the Menai Strait towards the dark, jagged, plum outline of Snowdonia, Laura took a deep breath and steeled herself. "Here we go." Breaking into a run, she watched as the freezing water raced towards her feet and then covered them. Her shins splashed the sea, spraying water over her hips and then her torso. The momentum of her run carried her forward as she dived into the next wave and disappeared under it. For a second or two, she could feel nothing. That slight delay between the nerve receptors in her skin and her brain connecting. Then the sharp, uncomfortable shock of the cold rushed in. She broke the surface and gave an immense gasp. Endorphins zipped through her. Adrenaline, dopamine, and serotonin. The legal, natural highs provided by the miracle that is the human body. All the stress, anxiety, and repetitive thinking that she had woken with that morning were simply blasted away. "Wow." "Better?" Rosie asked with a grin as she bobbed around in the cold sea. "Much," Laura laughed, as she pushed her own blonde hair back off her face. It was so lovely to see a smile on her daughter's face. "I'm making fajitas tonight, if you fancy," Rosie said, as her teeth started to chatter. "Are you indeed?" Laura smiled. "Steak or chicken?" Rosie asked. "Oh God, chicken," Laura replied. "You know what a fusspot Jake is. One tiny speck of red in his steak and he'll refuse to eat the lot, just like his dad." Rosie blinked, tipping her shoulders back under the water. "Is he?" "Your dad had to have everything cooked through. In fact, he preferred most things burned to a crisp," Laura explained with a laugh. "Isn't that really unhealthy? Like carcinogenic? I did tell him that all the time." "I don't think I knew that about him," Rosie said, deep in thought. "Am I like him?" "Of course," Laura replied. "Stubborn, cheeky, untidy. Hey!" Rosie laughed and splashed water at her. Laura looked at her. "You're like your dad in lots of lovely ways. For instance, you're kind and genuinely interested in helping other people." Rosie nodded and then pointed to her face. "Yeah, and I've got his stupid thick eyebrows that I have to pluck on a daily basis," Laura smiled at Rosie. It wasn't just the eyebrows. She also had Sam's dark, hooded eyes and long eyelashes. She glanced out across the water and saw a shadowy outline bobbing around on the surface, distracting her from the conversation. It could have been nothing more than the light and early morning mist playing tricks, but it looked as if someone was swimming out there. It had been nearly 4 years since Sam, her husband and Rosie's father, had been killed in the line of duty in Manchester. Laura had been at the warehouse where Sam had died that day, 12th of August 2018. It was a date that would be etched in her memory.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.